Hello, class 7. Welcome back. How are you all doing, children? Children, before I continue with the remaining part of the chapter, let us first see how you have done your first assignment. Okay. So I'll be telling you the answers. You need to cross-check your answers with mine. If there is any mistake, you need to correct it. Okay. Now, one thing remember, any homework which is given in book will be done in book only. You don't have to copy it down in copy in your notebook. Okay. Your notebook will have only the question answer part or the reference to context part or any other such question in which writing needs to be done. And those questions will be basically from the questions that are based on the chapter. Okay. In case you get any work that is to be done in the book and it is mentioned, the page number is mentioned, that means that work has to be done in the book only. You do not have to copy that question in your notebook and then do it. Okay. That you don't have to do, right? So let us come to the answers. Now you were given from page number 5, you were given A part and B part, and from A you had to do the first two sentences, and from B part also you had to do first two questions. Okay. The A part was tick the correct answer, and the first sentence was Mr. Nuttall did not think that, and out of the three options, the correct option is visiting strangers would soothe his nerves. Mr. Nuttall did not think that visiting strangers would soothe his nerves. He always had that doubt in his mind that how meeting strangers in a strange place is going to help him overcome his anxiety issues. Okay. And the second sentence is Mr. Nuttall's sister gave him letters of introduction to help him make new friends. The correct answer is help him make new friends, because she knew that her brother was a very shy person, doesn't mix up with people very easily. So to make his transition from the city to the village area more smooth, she wrote few letters of introduction to few of the members of that area whom she had known personally when she was living there. And that she did hoping that when her brother will give these letters to those people, after reading letter, they will very quickly befriend, will very quickly accept, Mr. Nuttall, and he'll be more comfortable with those people. So that was the purpose of writing letter for those people. Okay. Now come the B part. In B part, there were two questions given. First question was, why did Mr. Nuttall move to the countryside? The answer is Mr. Nuttall moved to the countryside on doctor's advice because he had some nerve issues, within bracket you can say anxiety issues, and to overcome that problem, health problem or mental problem, the doctors had advised him to move to a countryside which has a more peaceful environment. Okay. Second question was, what did Mr. Nuttall's sister say about his move to the countryside? Mr. Nuttall's sister says that if he moves to the countryside, his nervous issue will become worse rather than improving, because even though if he goes there, he will not mix up with the people, he will not acquaint himself with the people. As a result, most of his time will be spent in the loneliness, and that is why she tells him that she is going to write letters of introduction to few of the members of the village whom she had known when she was living there. It's a slightly longer answer, but that's the correct answer. So far, we have read that Mr. Frampton Nuttall, who was suffering from a nervous issue, that is the anxiety issue, he was advised by the doctors to move to a countryside, that is a village area, so that his problem can improve, because the environment of village is quite peaceful. So, on the doctor's advice, he decides to go to a village. And the same village his sister had been living around 4 years back. Okay. So when he tells his sister about his decision of moving to the village, his sister says that being a shy person, he's not going to mix up with the people very fast. As a result, most of his time will be spent in loneliness. As a result, rather than improving, his anxiety issue, his nerve issue is going to worsen. So to avoid that, to help him, adjust easily, comfortably and quickly in a new environment, in the village environment, what she does was that she wrote few letters to few of the people of that area where who were quite nice to her, and she gave those letter of introduction to him and told him that when you go there, you have to give these letters to the respective people, and as a result, you'll have you'll be able to make friends quickly. So with that letter of introduction, he goes to the village, and on reaching there, he goes to one of the houses which belonged to Mr. and Mrs. Sappleton. So when he knocked at the door, Mrs. Sappleton was not there, but her niece Vera opened the door, and she received him. And in absence of Mrs. Sappleton, she gave him company. And she started, after some time, she started talking to him, and the first thing she asked about to Frampton was that if he knows anybody or anything about this village, to which Frampton says that he doesn't know anyone, and not even Mrs. Sappleton. He only knows her name and the address because it was written on the letter of introduction. And then Vera says that it means he doesn't know anything that has happened in Mrs. Sappleton's life about the great tragedy. So when Frampton heard that tragedy word, he was quite surprised, because for him, village area is quite peaceful, and there are very few, problems. There are very few incidences of tragedy. So when Vera mentions about Mrs. Sappleton's tragedy, he was quite surprised. Okay, so this was where we had stopped last time, and now we'll continue with the remaining part of the chapter. Okay, now one thing you must remember, the chapter will be explained in three videos. Okay, first video you already got last time, this is the second video, and the third video will be also coming up. So you have make sure that you watch both the second as well as the third videos in order to get the complete story of this chapter. That will help you answer each and every question very easily and quickly, right? And try to answer them in your own words rather than copying from the book. You may wonder why we keep that window wide open on an October afternoon, said the niece, indicating a large French window that opened on to a lawn. It is quite warm for the time of the year, said Frampton. But has that window got anything to do with the tragedy? When Frampton says, what's the tragedy? What happened in her life? So Vera, she points at the window which was there in the living room. It was a French window which was opening onto a lawn. So she pointed at that window and she said that, you must be wondering, it's the month of October and it's quite warm, and still we have kept the window open. So you must be thinking that why we have done so. So Frampton says, okay, yes, that's true. And then he asks that keeping that window open, does it has anything to do with her tragedy? Out through that window, 3 years ago to a day, her husband and her two young brothers went off for their day's shooting. They never came back. In crossing the moor to their favorite snipe shooting ground, they were all three engulfed in a treacherous piece of bog. So Vera answers it, and she says, through that window 3 years ago, my aunt's husband, that is Mr. Sappleton, and two of Mrs. Sappleton's brother went off to their shooting. They went for hunting, and since then they have never come back. And while hunting, they had to cross a moor. Moor is a bushy area, a highland, which is covered with grasses and bushes. She says that in order to reach the snipe shooting ground, snipe is a kind of a bird, okay, which was found there during that time of the year. So she says that 3 years ago, my uncle and his two brother-in-laws went through that window for a snipe shooting, and in order to reach the snipe shooting ground, they had to cross a moor. And while they were crossing the moor, they were all engulfed in the bog, in the dangerous, treacherous means dangerous piece of bog. Now bog is a wet and soft land, that is it's quite swampy, you can say daldal, we call it daldal in Hindi. Okay, so she said that 3 years ago they went there, and while they were going towards their hunting ground, they had to cross a moor, and in that area, that moor area had become quite boggy, and the moment they stepped onto it, they were all engulfed, they were all pulled down by the bog, and they never came back since then.
It had been that dreadful wet summer, you know, and places that were safe in other years gave way suddenly without warning. Their bodies were never recovered. That was the dreadful part of it. Here, the child's voice lost its self-possessed note and became falteringly human.
Then she further explains that, you know, the area, the moor area, that, you know, grassy, bushy area, generally is used, it used to be very dry and it used to be a very safe passage. But that year, it had rained so much that the safe passage, that moor area, it had become boggy. And as a result, they did not realize how boggy, how swampy that area had become, and as a result they thought that the area is just the same as it always used to be. So without any hesitation they moved towards it, but the moment they went there they were all pulled down by the bog, and as a result their bodies were never recovered. When they did not come back from hunting, people went out in search for them, but nobody found their body. And that was the most dreadful part, that missing them was okay, was also one of the thing, but not being able to recover their body was another bad happening. And while saying that, her voice became little shaky.
Poor aunt always thinks that they will come back someday, they and the little brown spaniel that was lost with them, and walk in at that window just as they used to do. That is why the window is kept open every evening till it is quite dusk. Poor dear aunt, she has often told me how they went out, her husband with his white waterproof coat over his arm, and Ronnie, her youngest brother, singing, "Bertie, why do you bound?" as he always did to tease her, because she said it got on her nerves.
Vera further continues with her story of the tragedy, and she tells Mr. Nuttall that, you know, my aunt, she has not accepted the reality. My aunt doesn't believe that her husband and her two brothers are dead. She still believes that someday they are going to come back from the same window, and they will be accompanied by a brown spaniel. Now, spaniel is a breed of dog. It's a hunting dog. Okay, so when Mr. Sappleton had gone out for hunting, he was accompanied by their spaniel dog also. So Vera says that my aunt still thinks that one day will come when her husband, her two brothers and her dog are going to return from their hunt, and when they'll do so, they will enter the house from the same window from where they had gone out. And that is the reason why every day we keep the window open from morning till dusk. Okay, now dusk, last year also I've explained to you, dusk is the time, that time of evening when it is not totally dark. There is still little light. The sun has set, but it is not totally dark. Okay, so that part of evening when there is still light, though the light is very less, but it's still, you can still see few of the things. Okay, you can still see things. So that part of evening is called dusk. So Vera says that every morning we open the window and we keep it open till the dusk time, and after that, when the night comes, then we close the window. And she also says, you know, many a times my aunt has also told me how her husband, that is Mr. Sappleton, used to go out, how he used to dress up. And then she used to say that, you know, whenever my husband used to go, he used to have a white waterproof coat. He used to hang a white waterproof coat over his arm just in case it rains, or just in case it's too, you know, swampy or it's too wet area, then he could, you know, protect himself by wearing that waterproof coat. And whenever they used to go out for hunt, her younger brother, whose name was Ronnie, used to always sing to Mrs. Sappleton that, "Bertie, why do you bound?" Bertie is the first name of Mrs. Sappleton. Okay, keep that in mind. Bertie, why do you bound? So Bertie is the full name of, Bertie Sappleton is the full name of Mrs. Sappleton. Okay, so every time he used to sing this because it used to irritate Mrs. Sappleton.
Do you know, sometimes on still, quiet evenings like this, I almost get a creepy feeling that they will all walk in through that window. She broke off with a little shudder. It was a relief to Frampton when the aunt bustled in the room with a whirl of apologies for being late in making her appearance. "I hope Vera has been amusing you," she said. "She has been very interesting," said Frampton.
And then Vera says that, "You know, sometimes when I'm sitting here in the living area and it is almost the dusk time, many times I have that creepy feeling, that uncomfortable, that uneasy feeling that, you know, what my aunt believes is going to happen in reality. That means I feel as if my uncle and his two brother-in-laws along with the dog are going to come back from that window." And she was about to continue, but suddenly she was interrupted when Mrs. Sappleton entered into the room, because she was quite late in making her appearance in front of Mr. Frampton. She started apologizing for her late appearance. And then she asked Mr. Sappleton if Vera had been amusing you. Amusing you means, in other words, she was asking Frampton if Vera had given him a good company. And to which Frampton says that, yes, she had been very interesting.
"I hope you don't mind the open window," said Mrs. Sappleton briskly. "My husband and brothers will be home directly from shooting, and they always come in this way. They have been out for snipe in the marshes today, so they'll make a fine mess over my poor carpets. So like you menfolk, isn't it?"
Then Mrs. Sappleton asked very briskly, that is, briskly means she quickly asked Frampton that, "You know, I hope I have kept the window open, and I hope you don't mind that open window, because, you know, very soon my husband and my brother will be coming back from shooting, and they always enter the house from this window. They do not enter from the main door, but they always come through in this window, and that is why I have kept the window open. And, you know, today only they have gone to the marshes for to hunt for the snipe. And, you know, I know that area is quite, you know, wet. As a result, their shoes will be totally soiled, totally covered in mud. And the moment they will enter the house through that window, the carpet which is laid near the window will be totally soiled. And I know that they will not, you know, pay a heed. They will not care about spoiling the carpet, because it is so like menfolk. Like, that means it is a common, it is a nature, it's a basic nature of a man that they do not care for the cleanliness of the house. So that was her way of, you know, talking about or telling Frampton that why she had kept the window open.
She rattled on cheerfully about the shooting and the scarcity of birds and the prospects for duck in the winter. To Frampton, it was all purely horrible. He made a desperate but only partially successful effort to turn the talk onto a less ghastly topic. He was conscious that his hostess was giving him only a fragment of her attention, and her eyes were constantly straying past him to the open window and the lawn beyond. It was certainly an unfortunate coincidence that he should have paid his visit on this tragic anniversary.
Now, Mrs. Sappleton kept on talking about the hunting season, how during, you know, some part of the year they get less birds to hunt, and sometimes during winters when there are many ducks, more ducks arriving in that area, so that time of the year, the winter time of the year, they have a good hunt. They are able to have a good hunt. So when she was talking about all this shooting and hunting, she was very cheerful. She was very happy. But to Frampton, it was a horrible experience. He was feeling very uncomfortable listening to all that talk of hunting. And in order to change the topic, he tried to change the topic, but he was not very successful. He was only partially successful. He tried to talk about something he was more comfortable about. And he knew that, you know, when he tried to change the topic, he was talking to Mrs. Frampton. He was very, you know, aware of the fact that Mrs. Sappleton was not giving him full attention, because her eyes were totally time and again looking towards the window and on towards the lawn. And that made him feel, that made Mr. Frampton feel, that it was very unfortunate that the day when, that is today, the day when her husband had gone for the shooting, that tragic incident happened that is the day that he is visiting Mrs. Appleton's house. So that thought was going on in Frampton's mind.